that women in ministry face today. As of 2016, for Christian denominations, 1 in 5 Protestant seminarians are female. However, only 1 in 10 pastors are female. In 2016, Pope Francis made a highly controversial announcement. He announced that he was going to convene a council to discuss the potential of ordaining women, not just as deacons, but as full-functioning ordained priests of the Roman Catholic Church. This was highly controversial because he received backlash from not just conservative Catholics, but conservative Protestants as well. For our Jewish sisters, approximately 40 to 68% of the students in non-Orthodox Jewish seminaries are women. One such seminary, the Reform Judaism's Hebrew Union College, has ordained over 800 women to today. For the Christian women, only a handful of Christian denominations ordain women or support the ordination of women. And they include the American Baptist Churches USA, the Episcopal Church, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, the International Church of the Four Square Gospel, the Presbyterian Church USA, the United Church of Christ, and the United Methodist Church. It should be noted that each of these denominations are more liberal branches of their traditional denominations. For example, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America ordains women. They're currently being led by women. However, the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod does not. And this issue was one of the issues that caused a split from the traditional Lutheran faith. As you can see, some of these denominations have 3 asterisks, which signify that they are currently being led by a woman, whereas denominations with only 1 asterisk shows churches that have previously been led by women. For Jewish women who wish to go into ministry, they have even fewer options in the Jewish faith. There are only 3 Jewish branches that will accept an ordained woman. They include Conservative Judaism, Reform Judaism, and finally, Reconstructionist Judaism. It should be noted that in the United States, Orthodox Judaism does not ordain women, nor do they support the ordination of women. For female rabbis, there is a lot to consider. As I mentioned in the previous slide, women who wish to serve in synagogues as rabbis still face firm resistance in the Orthodox communities. Those who have gone to Jewish seminaries that ordain them often face being banned from serving as rabbis or other clergy members in the Orthodox synagogues. However, it is interesting to note that in Israel, where it is predominantly Orthodox Jewish communities, women enjoy a greater acceptance there than they do in the United States. And for those who are accepted, that's not the end of the obstacles for them. They still have to face certain discrimination and even condescending remarks from their colleagues and from the congregations they try to serve. Female rabbis are often referred to as rabba or maharat over the traditional male title of rabbi. It must be noted that the terms rabba or maharat are used for women only, just women. this differentiates the female rabbis from the real rabbis. And it is used to reduce female rabbis to secondary status. Essentially, yes, you've received your diploma, you have received your ordination, but you're not really a rabbi. You are not one of us. And one female rabbi who knows this situation quite keenly would be Rabbi Sally Priesand. Rabbi Priesand was born June 27th of 1946 in Cleveland, Ohio, to Orthodox Jewish parents who took a step from tradition and encouraged their daughter to fulfill whatever calling God gave her. They encouraged her through childhood to where she became duly enrolled at Hebrew Union College and the Jewish Institute of Religion. She graduated with high honors. She was in the top percentile of her class in 1968 with Bachelor's of Arts in Hebrew Letters and English. In 1975, she defended her master's thesis that was titled Historic and Changing Roles of the Jewish Woman. Not only did this speak to her own story, but she looked at the women who came before her to understand how she has been brought to this time, to this opportunity. And she was able to use her voice in her own time to give voice to the women who came before her. However, despite all of her achievements, despite all of her hard work, her commitment, in her predominantly male class, she was the last student to be employed. She finally celebrated her greatest achievement by becoming the first ordained female rabbi in the United States on June 3rd, 1972 at the Plum Street Temple in Cincinnati, Ohio. She then became rabbi of the Monmouth Reformed Temple in Tinton Falls, New Jersey in 1981. She described her time at Monmouth as being a very educational experience because she originally wanted to serve at a larger synagogue with large numbers, not unlike women who would like to serve in mega churches in the Christian denominations. After a few months, she began to realize that God truly did call her to a smaller synagogue, because by preaching and serving a smaller community, she was able to be more involved in the lives of the people she served, and she was able to give all of her love, all of her devotion. And she did this with great joy until her retirement on June 30th, 2006. As I would like to point out, this isn't just one problem for one denomination. This is across the board for women. We just looked at the Jewish obstacles that women face there. Now, let us look towards the Roman Catholic Church. The woman in this photo is what you would call a mother superior. Mothers superior are very important because they are responsible for the physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual welfare of the women that are under them. She is also important because it took mother superiors a very long time to get where they are, because becoming a nun is a very complicated process. For the first 2 years, you are a postulant, meaning you're going through a period of discernment to determine if this is the lifestyle you want to be in, and if you have the commitment to take vows that are very hard to break once you have taken them. And then for 6 months to 18 months, they take the lighter vows of a novice, again, a second period of discernment, before taking the full vows of a nun, also known as taking the veil. These women commit to the vows of poverty, prayer, obedience, and chastity. And they do this knowing that they are giving up their livelihood, They are giving up their lifestyle. They are giving up the opportunity to have children, to be married. They are also making the vow that they will submit to Mother Church and those who run the church. For women in the Roman Catholic Church, a Mother Superior is the highest rank she can achieve at this time. And this is very important for when you look at the hierarchy of the Catholic Church in whole, because it says in canon law, a baptized male alone, receives sacred ordination validly, meaning only men can receive valid ordination. If, say, the bishop in Portland were to take Sister Rachel and ordain her as a priest, not only would the Vatican consider this ordination invalid, that bishop would probably be on the first plane to Rome to be defrocked. Here's the predominantly male hierarchy of the Catholic Church. First you've got the laity, then the postulants, the novices, the nuns, and then finally, the Mother Superior. However, as I said, this is the highest rank she can achieve. She then submits to the lowest ranking male in the church hierarchy. So that would be the local parish priest, who then answers or submits to the bishop, the archbishops, the cardinal, and then finally, the pope. So even though she has achieved the highest rank for a woman in the Catholic Church, she's still answering to the lowest rank of the hierarchy. However, that does not make a Mother Superior invalid or weak in any way. It is often noted that nuns, especially Mother Superior, are often higher educated. They often have high degrees in not just religion, but in sciences and psychology. Whereas with some priests and monks, you're not going to get that same level of education. This is Mother Superior, Mother Mary Claire Malia, who took the veil in 1965. So she's been playing this game for quite a while. She served as Mother Superior of Catholic Apostles of the Sacred Heart of Jesus from 2004 to 2016. She has a PhD in science. She also has a JD in canon law, and serves as a canon law attorney for the Vatican. In 2009, she was also appointed an apostolic visitor for the Vatican, which, as she put it, was more or less being sent on a goodwill mission that she considered to be a bit of a farce. However, she took that goodwill mission and she used it to bring to light the struggles that women deal with in the Catholic Church. She visited U.S. convents across the country to interview nuns regarding the challenges they face as sisters, what they struggle with the most, what in their life they find most enjoyable. However, she faced great resistance from the monastic communities, as well as from nuns who thought she might be creating trouble. In her 50,000-word report, it showed that postulants were at a historic low, and that for those women who have taken the higher vows, many were going through Vatican process, which can take years, to abandon their vows. She also wrote that women are reluctant to enter holy orders because of the impenetrable Roman Catholic Church glass ceiling that women have yet to break. So we have looked at the Jewish situation, we have looked at the Catholic situation. Now let us look at aspiring female pastors who are inspired to go into ministry and are often crushed. Growing up, many of these girls are encouraged to pursue their vocational dreams, being told that they can do anything God calls them to do, only to be rejected either as a young girl or even going into seminary and seeking ordination. Because women who graduate from seminary are not guaranteed ordination or even appointment. They get the degree and then they're told, there's no place for you here. This is because church leaders often refuse to allow ordained clergywomen in their pulpits to preach or to even lead the congregation. Because those who do allow it incur a rising backlash from their peers who are telling them that what they're doing is unbiblical, that it is evil, and in the case of the women, they're being told that what they're doing is demonic because it directly contradicts scripture. And even worse of all, many of these women don't get support from the people they need it the most. Their families and their home churches or denominations tell them that they will receive no support from them. One such woman who overcame this is the Right Reverend Vashti Murphy McKenzie. She was born on May 28, 1947, a couple of decades before traditional denominations even considered discussing a woman's role in the church beyond the traditional roles. In 2000, she became the first female bishop to serve the African Methodist Episcopal Church. She is still in this position today. In fact, her tenure ends in 2020. So she's going to be a bishop for 20 years. She was appointed by President Barack Obama to serve on the Advisory Council of White House Faith-Based and Neighborhood Partnership, a committee that talks about racism, that talks about gender inequality, and other social justice issues. She was also invited to preach at the annual White House Easter Prayer Breakfast under President Obama in 2010, an honor that is unheard of being offered to women. However, she said that her greatest achievement was being named by the Huffington Post as one of the world's 50 most powerful women religious leaders in 2015. To her, this was a tribute to the strength she needed to overcome her obstacles. Just like Mother Malia, just like Rabbi Prezant, each of these women had to find their own strength to overcome the obstacles so that they could fulfill the calling that God and God alone gave them. Thank you. I would like to thank my capstone sisters, Olivia, Mackenzie, and Elena, for being my guide, my support, for keeping me from completely falling apart this week. I would also like to thank Dr. Marianne Winter-Messier for the support she has shown me in pursuing my own calling and keeping me grounded and always being there when I need her the most. I would say that if you feel, or if you know, that God has called you to it, go after it. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. And if you face criticism, to hell with the consequences, because if God has called you, he will not let anyone get in your way.
All right.
Yes.
Yeah, I just thought it was interesting how they would let Mother Malia operate as an attorney for the Vatican, but maybe not operate in like a role in within the church. So I guess it kind of makes you wonder. I don't know if you would know this or have looked at the research, but are there any themes, or do you feel like there's any future implications for how churches or different denominations might become affirming of women in leadership roles?
That's a very good question. I have noticed that in churches across the board, there is what I'm hoping is potentially a shift. I mean, when I heard Pope Francis's announcement, I cheered. Because even though it might not happen in my lifetime, that means someone is willing to start the conversation. And I'm not just seeing that in the Catholic Church, I'm seeing it in more traditional conservative Christian denominations who even 10 years ago wouldn't have even heard of that discussion.
As you mentioned, the Pope calling the council, I was just wondering what your thoughts on what it would take for women to break their box ceiling in the Roman Catholic Church. Maybe some practical and then some in the future.
Well, I think, at the very least, the least political correct term I can come up with is for some of the men to just get out of the way, to allow for women to pursue their callings and to let them shine. As for practical, once the discussion is there, my prayer is that God will use that as an opportunity to turn hearts and to bring out the scriptures that people have been using against female ordination for years and see them in their proper light.
Do you have any statistics or knowledge about how often women start churches apart from denominations?
That is a good question. It didn't really come up in my research, but it's definitely a subject that I am interested in pursuing.
Would you mind if I add something to that?
Please.
I don't know numbers either, but there are more and more women because as they feel pressed by a call to ministry from God and they don't find an outlet within organized religion, tend to create their own as a means of, I need to express this call, live this call that I've been given. And so may God open a door for me to do that, but the church will not have me because they're not willing to just accept the no from the church and then infer that God never called them. So these sorts of things, as the four women that we saw in the beginning, are on the rise because it's one way that women can pursue the calling that they feel God has given them. Would you concur?
Yes.
Do you see a causal relationship between the expectation of inclusive language in church settings and the willingness to ordain women and see them in the pulpit?
I'm not entirely sure I understood what you're saying, Dr. Crowe. Can you say it one more time?
Well, in the 70s, when some of these churches began ordaining women, there was also a movement to expect inclusive language, especially inclusive language relating to God or to people in the church and that kind of thing. And I'm wondering whether the language caused the tendency to ordain women, or whether the tendency to ordain women caused the inclusive language, or if they just are coming out of a common kind of environment.
Well, one thing you and I have discussed is that both of these aspects, the ordination of women and far greater tendency toward inclusive language, including, for example, rewriting of hymnals. Mm-hmm. So a whole study of hymnody that has significantly changed. And all of this, for the most part, occurs within the more liberal branches. Mm-hmm. So we may not know chicken or egg first, but that's where they're rooted. And in the evangelical or the more conservative branches, this is what you were talking about earlier, we don't see this.
I would agree with what Dr. Wintermossier has said. That is my understanding. I've also noticed, especially in my History of the Bible in English class, that around the same time these conversations were taking place, newer revisions of the Bible started including inclusive language. Instead of saying mankind, actually using man and woman. and other exclusive language. So
inclusive.
Inclusive, thank you. Inclusive language that made women feel like they were being, that the message was applying to them as well as the men. So I think we're starting to see this across the board.
I have a note and a question. A note in your list of denominations that do ordain women that you did not include the Disciples of Christ, which of course is heritage to our own institution, which does ordain women, so far as I know. I also wanted to know if in your research you talked to any local women rabbis or pastors. You have a great example of some sort of historical, high-powered, well-known women, but I wonder if you talked with any local folk.
Well, in answer to the note, I pulled this from the Pew Research studies, and they had not included Disciples of Christ on their list, and it had occurred to me, but I have had friends who attend Disciple of Christ, and apparently, maybe it's just their congregation alone, but their pastors preach against women being at the pulpit or leading congregations. As for the question, I thought about it many times. I would have loved to, but I didn't have the time or the resources to go through an IRB, which I would have needed in order to speak to local women. Though my plan is, once the capstone is taken care of, I do want to start meeting with women like that so I can get more of a local story.
That's also a great PhD dissertation. Thank you,
colleagues. Oh, yes. So you mentioned about President Obama appointing Reverend. Yes. Did you say why he chose her specifically?
He chose her because he had been following her story very carefully. They had met a few times, and he was very impressed with not just her credentials, but what her congregation had to say about her. And when he went into office, one of the biggest, what would it be, hot phrase, hot word? Anyways.
Hot buzzword.
Thank you. Buzzword was inclusivity. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the best ways to embody that principle is by taking an individual, in this case a colored woman, who has faced discrimination all over the board, and letting her have a moment to have her moment so she can use her voice and her experience to better the lives of others.
Please join me in thanking Ms. Thank you so much for joining us today, and special thanks to those of you who've been here the whole afternoon. We really appreciate your support.
Right. There were two quarters of my
phone. Oh, I found one of them.
Lauren, take care. Good to see you.
You too. Nice to see
right,
you too.
Take care.
Yes.